Blog Talk Radio.
Yo, Tone, turn up the kick, man.
Yeah, that feel good.
Rolling through the hood one day, about a year ago, met a Houston, had to let her know that she was justified in being my type. She had a curly weaver, was a cornrow, whatever you want to call it, she was so cold. Even wore a platinum chain, in a platinum ring, spinning platinum chain. Was more than one night stand, but I didn't know that she would make me want to stay in the ghetto. But she's the kind of girl that you don't let go. I got me a ghetto girl, a body that sounds too right. She never wanna leave my side. Got a little attitude, and that's just what I like. She's my ghetto girl, she fits in my ghetto world. Kind of girl, but I'm loving everything about her. My girl, I like the way you keep your head here, singing nails and toes on right. So when you wake up, I do it still right. I love the way you keep it real. You got a sexy little plug appeal. Ain't gotta worry about no Hollywood, cause it's understood, you can keep it
good. I'm not kind of freak, I can see that.
You need to get no kind of love, well, I'ma be that. Cause you're the kind of girl you don't let go. I got me a ghetto girl, the one that's out to ride.
Well, all right. Hello, 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 hello out there in Blog Talk Radio land and across the globe, my darlings. I hope you have all of your crumpets together, baby, because you know what time it is, darlings. It's time to dish tea, and you're dishing tea, darlings. Ah, with Big Meat, honey. Hey, babies, what seems to be the problem with you today? Honey, I'm sitting up here. When I tell you a bitch is evil right now, I mean it, okay? I am upset because I had to upgrade my telephone. Now, y'all know, being technologically sound in this era that we're in, we all end up having to upgrade these old stupid-ass phones, right? Well, I have a Huawei Premier from Metro PCS. Now, I just got this damn phone last Tuesday. Do you know, I done called Huawei 4 times since I've had this phone. Now, the first couple of times, honey, it was network issues, and I didn't realize that and this, that, and the third. But now, all of my contacts, not my contacts, my musical files, my picture files, and carrying on are not in this phone. I woke up this morning, I tried to hook the phone up to the computer so I could upload, download, or whatever. And the damn phone is not even registering in the computer. The computer don't even know that the phone is there. It's charging, but it's not even saying that it's registered in the computer. I can't even pull it up. I can't do nothing with it. So now I'm going to just call Huawei again for them to tell me, oh, you need to take this back to your carrier and see what's going on. Now, y'all know I'm going to get rid of this damn phone, right? I'm going to go up in here in Metro PCS, and I'm going to be in love. I'm not gonna flip over chairs or nothing. But they're going to take this damn phone back. It's only been 8 days that I've had it. They're going to take it back, and they're going to do something. I'm not accepting. We're going to give you a replacement phone. I'm not giving them no more damn money. We're going to get rid of this damn phone because I've only had it for 8 days and uncalled the manufacturer four different times about this damn phone. Now, I always upgrade every 2 years. It's only been 8 days. Child, we're not going to go through this. We ain't going to go. No, we ain't. Mm-mm. No, we not. No, Jesus. Mm-mm. Mm-mm. No. Mm-mm. Mm-mm. So that there is my that's my dilemma today as far as dealing with this damn telephone. I'm so sick of this. I'm sick of this. I'm very thankful, though, that the pictures that I had on the phone are backed up on my computer somewhere. I'm hoping. No, I know that they are, but I got to now find where the folders that I put them in so that I can go look at them and this, that, and the third. You know what I'm saying? So, yeah, that there is what's happening on this glorious day, darlings. I know it's a child. Y'all know my life is a complete production. Okay, completely, completely, completely. However, I'm still glad that you're here, and we're going to keep things moving right along. Tonight being May 1st, I want to say happy birthday to someone very special and dear to me. I'm not going to call his name because he gets off persnickety and things about that kind of stuff because he's a private person. However, someone who I hold to my heart is today is his birthday, honey. And he done hit one of the milestone ages. So, yeah, I'll be right there with you in about a couple of years, honey. So, yeah, he's 2 years my senior. But it's okay. We're right there at the same ages and carrying on. So, happy birthday to you publicly and all of that. So we're going to get things started. If you're joining in and would like to join in on the conversation, the call-in number is 347-205-9183. That's 347-205-9183. And when you call in, just press the number 1 and you will show up on my call queue that you have something to say, and then I'll get to you at the appropriate time. If you have questions, comments, concerns, want to be a guest on the show, want to be a sponsor, because I am needing sponsors, and all of that, you can simply go to the website. We're at www.dishingtea.com. That's www.dishingtea.com. Or you can simply email me directly at bigmeach, B-I-G-M-E-A-C-H. That's B-I-G-M-E-A-C-H at dishingtea.com. Yes, my darlings. And over at the website, honey, you can see all of the, you know, what's going on with us. If you would like to participate, we're putting together one of my production, my baby, No Time for the Pain. So we're looking for sponsors for that. If you want to help us by putting an advertising in our program, booklet, and carrying on, all that information is there. You get all the links to the web pages, to the Facebook. Meet me on Twitter. I've got to build my Twitter followage up, honey. I didn't realize I was so low in Twitter followage. Y'all could tweet me at BigMeach1 on Twitter. All the Facebook pages are there. And also, if you have not gotten your copy of Awakenings, Epiphanies Along a Spiritual Journey, my current book, you can also order your copy there. I autograph all of my books, so get your autographed copy from www.dishingtea.com, okay? The tea room is open, so if you're listening by computer and want to chat with all the folks over there, it's just me in there right now. But go right on over there and entertain yourselves, honey. I'll be popping in and making sure that everything is all kosher and things. Remember, over in the tea room, honey, This is the written word. Y'all know we're in this technological age, and we seem to have lost the art of communication, I'm really starting to believe, because we're typing and texting and everything. But over there in the tea room, honey, sometimes we bring our own personal experiences to what we're reading, and we may think that somebody's trying to come out of a bag on us, and that may not be the case. So just while you're dish your tea responsibly, please, okay? Dish your tea over there responsibly. And remember, honey, it's all right to disagree. Just don't be disagreeable. Because if I come in and find that y'all cutting up, honey, I will cut you to the white meat. How about that? Ah, okay? So, yeah, just dish your tea over there responsibly for me, all right? So now, I have a special announcement that I want to get out of the way right now, and that is the Shop Nibble Network, the Old School Bazaar, and it's happening this weekend, starting every weekend of May, Saturdays and Sundays. So this weekend, the 4th and the 5th, the 11th and the 12th, 18th and 19th, the 25th and the 26th of May, you will be at the Old School Bazaar. There's free admission. They will have DJ Ram this weekend at the Maggie Lee's Community Center in Detroit, Michigan. That's located at 7700 Puritan Avenue. And they're going to have a whole big old bazaar. They got vendors and everything that's going to be out there. So you got product, you got food, you have everything that you're going to need to have a very, very, very good time. They're doing the fish fry, child. So come on out there, get you a fish sandwich, you know, and do your thing, honey. Call it grace. You see what I'm saying? So, yeah, at Maggie Lee's Community Center, 7700 Puritan Avenue in Detroit, Michigan. If you have any questions or comments, please call 313-737-9042. 313-737-9042. That's the cell phone to Maggie Lee. Or at the office at 313-397-3539. 313-397-3539. And they also, they're looking for vendors still. If you want to come on a vendor, this is going to be a lovely event because you can come in and be a vendor all 8 days. Ha! All 8 days for one price. You get a one-time fee of $35. Yes, I said that right. A one-time fee of $35 can secure you a spot for all 8 days of this bazaar as a vendor. For more information, contact Peter Jackson of Federal's Treasure Box. He's one of the coordinators of this event. You can contact him at 248-688-5178. That's 248-688-5178 if you want to be a vendor at this wonderful bazaar. This is the Shop Nibble Network and the Old School Bazaar for May 2013, okay? So that there, honey, is what's going on in lovely old Detroit. That's positive. I won't get into all of the shenanigans that Detroit is going on. Okay? So that there is that. I'm going to put everything else together because y'all know how I do this. I'm going to take a little commercial break right now because I always, this opening thing, honey, I talk so much to where I dry myself out. So let me get some libation and entertain you a little bit more when we come back. Because when we come back from the other side of the break, I'm going to introduce to you a young man, honey, who is new to me. However, after looking over this, honey, I think this child has, he got a couple of pipes, baby. If any going to take this thing where he need to take it, I'm going to introduce to some and present to others. His name is Shaliek. He is on the scene, honey, and he got a couple of things that he got to say. So when we come back, honey, we're going to get into the lifestyle of Mr. Shaliek and find out exactly what it means, honey, about it takes blood, sweat, and tears to relinquish the past. That's what I call this show. It takes blood, sweat, and tears to relinquish the past. You'll understand that when I come back. All right, let me sit up here and get this thing together, and I will talk to you on the other side of this.
The internet sensation is now in print. Get your copy of the book that will not only change your life, but change your thinking as well. Awakenings, Epiphanies Along a Spiritual Journey, is a compelling collection of blogs that have been the pinnacle of spiritual development and discernment for its author, internet talk show host Big Meech. Not only does this body of work offer the insight from his life experiences, it provides the reader an amazing opportunity to go on a journey that will awaken insight into their own higher power while encouraging personal growth and spiritual development. With chapters such as, I cannot give you life, nor can I live it for you. Truth is a bad bitch. It's time for a career change. I am not your God. And in what love do you operate? You will be captivated and compelled to take the life lessons the book has to offer and apply them to your life. To get your copy today of Awakenings, Epiphanies Along a Spiritual Journey, go to www.dishingtea.com or you can find it on the web at www.amazon.com. Or if you prefer an ebook, find it at www.smashwords.com. Awakenings, Epiphanies Along a Spiritual Journey. Are you ready? Are you ready for the journey? Trigg Laboratories manufactures premium sexual wellness and consumer healthcare products and is the parent company of Wet International Incorporated, one of the world's best-selling lines of personal lubricants and intimacy products. We carry a large variety of personal and flavored lubricants, flavored heating massage lotions, and aromatherapy heating massage oils. Whether you need a little or a lot, Wet has you covered. Our line of high-quality, innovative, and unique products are formulated using only the finest ingredients at our FDA-approved facility, meeting the strictest manufacturing standards. Wet is available worldwide at specialty stores and online retailers and at pharmacies nationwide. For more information or to find a retailer near you, log on to www.stayswetlonger.com. Trigg Laboratories. We create fun, quality, trusted products to innovate your intimacy.
Now kicking the feeling.
If you're just joining us, my darlings, thank you for your love, your time, and your support. Honey, have your crumpets ready because it's time to dish tea. And you're dishing tea, darlings, ha, with Big Meat. Today's show, my darlings, I'm calling it Take Blood, Sweat, and Tears to Relinquish the Past. My guest today, we are going to continue our series with introducing to some and presenting to others the stylings of legends in the making. And like I said, my guest today is far from any kinds of exceptions to that. His name is Shaliek. He's been influenced by the greats. And when you are influenced by the greats and study the greats, you become one of the greats. And his first project was called I Don't Want to Be Famous. That was up under his belt. It was a mixtape that he had out. Shaliek has put his stamp on the world as a fierce contender in the business known as show. We will get all the tea on Shaliek and how his tenacity and perseverance keeps him on the cutting edge of the industry. We will also take a listen at some of the essence of his musical genius and take a look into his personal life and see how it influences the sound that makes him Shaliek. So, honey, are you ready for a delicious hot pot of tea? Well, get ready and let's welcome. This is the one and only. This is Mr. Shaliek. Hello there, Mr. Man. What's going on, player?
Hey, how you doing? I have to tell you, man, it takes blood, sweat, and tears to relinquish the past. I got to use that one. I got to use it.
You like that?
I got to steal it from you, man. I got to steal it.
For the okay, let me explain that. For those of you, this is why I say I needed to explain that. Blood, Sweat, and Tears is the name of the upcoming project that's soon to be released, and The Past is the name of the first single that's coming off the track. We're going to hear that in just a few moments.
Beautiful.
So that there
I
is.
I couldn't have said that
is,
any better, man. That was amazing when you said that. I was like, wow.
Oh, well, thank you. I do my best, or at least get up to making sure it's gonna hit the mark somewhere. You know. Well, all right then. I am very. First, let me just say thank you for coming on. Because you are new to my consciousness, honey. I'm sitting up here and I'm like, okay, I've never heard this name. And of course, as I'm doing my research and carrying on, I went back and found a couple of things and this and that. And I said, this boy got a catalog. Tell what? How come nobody knows this?
I've been working at it a long time. I started very, very young, and I've been going ever since.
All right, well then, okay, well then that's the perfect start of all of this. Of course, let's get the folks to understand exactly who Shaliek is and the components that make you up. Let's start right there at the beginning. Tell us that.
Okay, everyone, how y'all doing? My name is Shaliek. I'm a soul artist, soul R&B artist. I love all types of different types of music, but I'm just intrigued with soulful voices. I'm from the Bronx, New York. I grew up studying Sam Cooke and Donny Hathaway, Stevie Wonder, Johnny Mathis, you know, Frank Sinatra, and I've just always been intrigued with those voices, and, you know, I practice those, you know, voices every day. I practice my craft. I'm a songwriter. I'm also an actor and a model, you know, and I hear doing music.
All right, for being an actor, a model, a songwriter, singer, a soul singer. We haven't heard that. See, I know you. See, yeah, you said I'm a soul singer. We only hear that with children who are in, you know, they who's trying to revive that, you know, the neo-soul children, Erica and Anthony and Angie and all them. They always say that. But when you hear that, I'm a soul singer. And for me, that takes me back to 69, 70, you know, and in that era where we as a people were developing a sound that was totally unique, and the masses didn't know how to take it. You know, everything was always easy listening. They wanted pop. But then when the Soul Children, Aretha and all those girls, came into play, you know, it took that church sound out of the church and infused it with music, and then we got that feeling, we got this, we got that, you know. So that's what, when you said that like that, that takes me to that particular era. Now, here's the ticket, because you said Frank Sinatra is somebody that you listen to. Now, let me play on that for a minute.
So much, I'm sorry.
Yeah, go right there. Go right there. Take it.
Okay, it wasn't so much Frank for the soul. I listen to different types of music and different artists for different reasons. Frank just had, like, a smooth thing about him. He was always dressed, you know, just dressed very well. My grandfather, I did performances around the city. I'm from New York City. He would dress me in a suit. And, you know, he pointed him out to me. He's like, yo, you see how he dressed right there? That guy is sharp. And I looked at Frank Sinatra for his style. And just he was just a Casanova kind of smooth guy. And I was like, man, that's pretty dope right there. So he inspired that part of me.
Okay, well, cool. Because, see, now that's interesting. Because, see, that whole particular era was about class, style, and sophistication. Frank, Dean Martin, Sammy Davis, Jr., you know, Billy Eckstein, and all of those cats, you know, they were into that. So with you picking that and gleaning that from them, let's look at the industry today. What is it that Shaliek is going to give the industry that's missing outside of that particular kind of style? What is it that you feel your contribution would be for that soul singer that's going to come in and say, okay, this is my niche, and this is going to be my seat at the table?
Right. I think today, I mean, and not bashing any other artists, I think today we're missing passion. We're missing people that are passionate and sing with passion and conviction. I mean, we have some out here, but I feel like as a whole, I think the market and the music is missing that type of passion that we had back when Sam Cooke was doing it, and Aretha Franklin and all of these other great soul artists. You know, saying when they sang to you, you felt it, and you were moved, and they were on the stage, and they looked crazy in the face, and they were sweating, and I feel like now everyone's, you know, they're focused on how they look, or do I look good, or am I, you know, I don't want to get too sweaty. I feel like soul music, you got to take it there. You got to jump around, so you got to take it, whatever you have to do to you're in the moment, you know, and that's the type of artist that I am, and, you know, I aspire to be, you know, like the greats, like James Brown and those guys who just got lost in the music, lost the moment, and just gave it their role, you know, on stage.
Exactly. So I like that. See, okay, you already tickled me already. See, that, and I mean, you know, because, see, here's the thing. With music, I say this to every artist that I've interviewed, and I really believe that music is God's perfect language, okay?
Right.
I don't care what you're into, there's a song for it, good, bad, or indifferent, okay?
Absolutely.
So with that, if it's perfect, if music is God's perfect language, that means it's going to touch your soul perfectly. So you cannot stand there, you know, or at least not give me a passionate performance. Let me say it that way, because I know folks who can stand there and be flat-footed, but yet will wear your ass out. You know,
exactly.
You know,
yeah,
what I'm saying,
yeah, yeah.
And can deliver that with, you know, but then there are those, because I'm one, child, please, you know, I'm a Patti LaBelle nut, honey, who got the flying carrying on, child. Okay, roll on that damn flow, you know, because if it takes you there, it takes you there. Kick that damn shoe in the audience. Give me my pump back, though, girl. That's a $1,500 shoe. Okay, but. But I dig that, you know.
Yeah.
I dig that about that. So coming up into this, all right. Now I'm looking over your catalog and things, and then also understanding that you have worked with the children, honey. You got Jam and Lewis in your category, in your catalog. You got a Lucha Keys. You know, you got all the child. Okay, let's go into that. And let's talk about I don't want to fast forward too much, because I want folks to take time to get intimate with you. But let's go there and talk about the transition. Let's go from, okay, you got your humble beginnings, all right, and we talked about, you know, your influences and things. Now let's go from you having your influences to you saying, okay, this is what I want to do. And how did it lead you to working behind the scenes? Because you said you've been doing this for a long time. And so now, having paid those dues, I need to hear folks, hear your journey. Because a lot of folks don't understand the work involved in this. They think that because they could go to jail and they got a cute little rap song, or they wrote a little rap, they come out to jail and get a little contract, and then they blow up. You know, a lot of folks are trying to take that route, because we've had so many in this industry now who come from that particular scene. So they don't understand the work involved. So yeah, talk about that for a minute.
Definitely hard work, you know, and to bring it up again, blood, sweat, tears. It took blood, sweat, tears for me to get to the point that I'm, you know, where I'm at today. And I learned a lot along the way. You know, I did Showtime at the Apollo. That was my first really big thing, you know, that was ever televised, or, you know, it was my first, that was like the turning point in my career, I would say, because after that, people were, you know, starting to pay attention. Who's this kid singing this Stevie Wonder song in this suit on stage? You know, who's this guy? So what I did was I followed up with a whole bunch of performances in New York, just around the city. So I was always this young guy, maybe 14, 15, wearing a suit, singing in different, you know, nightclubs, you know, that whoever I was singing, I would just sing. And so I began to, you know, get noticed from people in the industry. And then a good friend of mine, Maria Davis, who does a very popular open mic, who, you know, she did it. I think it's over now at the particular location, but it was called the Soul Cafe on 42nd Street in Times Square. A lot of industry people would come in and, you know, check out the talent. So long story short, I got noticed by Universal Records. I got signed to a development deal. Basically, you know, they don't give those deals out anymore because, you know, it was expensive at the time to, you know, to coach me as an artist and to build me into, you know, pretty much artist development, basically, just, you know, nurture me into an artist that, you know, is going to be a superstar, basically. So I did that, wound up turning into a major record deal, and was given the opportunity to work with, you know, Alicia Keys and Jimmy, Terry Lewis, the Underdogs, which is Babyface producers. Scott Storch at the time was huge, and just a host of other crazy, incredible producers and songwriters. So I learned a lot. So, you know, and it led up to me meeting, you know, like I said, Jimmy Jam and Terry Lewis. And it was an amazing experience, you know, just sitting down and watching them work in the studio and build tracks from, you know, from scratch and, you know, just getting advice from them. So incredible.
Okay. So now you have become a student of the industry. At this particular point, or up to this point, what do you think has been the greatest lesson that you've learned about the business of this?
Right. I think the greatest, I mean, I learned many lessons, but I think the greatest to me is just keep keeping a positive group of people in your circle, people that are going to encourage you, people that are going to be smart-minded business people, and people that have your best interests at heart. I know sometimes it's hard to decipher who those people are, but you know, you come to a time you can feel it. You can feel when a person is not good for you, or you know, whatever reason you're keeping them around, you know, you keep them around. But you know, all negative energy, I like to just, you know, just leave it behind, and just focus on people that are gonna lift me up and encourage me. You know, when I started doing that, you know, things just started moving for me. You know, people just believed and they had my interests at heart. So, and then, you know, it's just hard work, you know, work ethic. Alicia Keys told me that, you know. She just, you know, we talked in the studio. She was just like, you know, it's nothing like a good work ethic. People know it's it. Not only do people know it's it, you know, it works, you know, internally, you know. And you can't, you're going to get somewhere with that good work ethic. You're gonna eventually break down doors and, you know, it may take a while, but, you know, if you're working hard, it's going to happen.
Mm-hmm. Now, let's break that down. And yeah. What I mean by that, because, see, I hear that often about a good work ethic, and the major thing I keep hearing, and I love the fact that this is one that is being pushed, and that is making sure that your group of people around you are, you know, have your best interest at heart. You know,
yeah.
I hear that everybody is saying that. Make sure that your team around you has your best interest at heart, and that there, you go through a lot of smoke screens in order to find that out, because it becomes that way.
Absolutely.
You know,
because you need the pillars to hold you up and keep you up, because there's so many things that in the business that you come across that can knock you down, and that will knock you down. I mean, it's inevitable, you know. So with the pillars, you know, they got you right there. Like, even when you're weak, they got you holding you up, you know, so it's important.
Exactly. Now, let's break down this work ethic, because this is the first time I've asked somebody this. Explain that. When you say work ethic, break that down on what that means to you, because a lot of folks don't understand that sleep becomes a luxury. You know, understanding that, okay, I may have pipes, but we have to learn how to vocalize every day. You know, what's your vocal regimen in order to make sure that I'm able to, where if I got this damn set to do, or I got to go here at 9 o'clock in the morning to Kelly and Michael and sing live, then I'm able to sing, you know, versus sitting up there saying, oh, I'm waking up and we haven't vocalized in the morning. You know, that's part of that grooming. So talk about that work ethic. Break it down and, you know, take it to its common denominator, because we always hear, oh, you need a good work ethic. But a lot of folks think because they point fingers and say, okay, I got to do this, I got to do this, that means something. Yeah. But they don't understand the behind the scenes. So break down work ethic.
My grandfather always told me, you know, it's just two words that I always remember him saying, and it's discipline and sacrifice. Both of those words together, if you're practicing those things, I mean, that embodies work ethic. You know, like you said, discipline, waking up, you know, vocalizing, you know, doing. And, you know, for me, I don't have a vocal coach at the moment, but I'm on YouTube. And I'm figuring out, you know, different vocal exercises, new exercises I can do to strengthen my voice and keep it lasting, you know, because, you know, when you tour as a vocalist, over the years, you know, when you're singing soul music is, you know, it's very intense. You know, it can be intense on your vocal cords and your voice. And I'm planning on being here for a long time, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And when I'm 70 and 80, I want to, you know, have a little something. So, you know, I'm on YouTube and I'm constantly, you know, searching for videos that you know, that can help my vocal cords and just keep it around for a long time, sustain it, you know. So, you know, I certain type of foods I don't eat because I know it brings phlegm and it brings, you know, it does certain things with my vocal cords. I have to be disciplined and know I can't eat that. I can't drink this before a performance. I can't drink a lot of alcohol. I can't smoke. I can't smoke weed. I can't smoke cigarettes. A lot of people that I chill with or that I know, you know, are weed smokers, but I can't do that because I have a job. You know, I'm a singer, you know, and I have to stick to that. You know, no, I can't do that. Not because I don't want to do it, because I can't, because it's going to, you know, it's going to damage my vocal cords. This is my livelihood. And just sacrifice. It's a lot of times, you know, it's a party that I can't go to. Why? Because I have to go. I have to go to the studio, man. I can't rock with y'all tonight. You know, it's a pool party. What? Okay, cool. Y'all have fun. You know, show me some pictures of the shorties with the bathing suits on, and you know, I can't rock. But tonight, I have to go to work.
Right,
you know,
right.
I have deadlines. You know, and a lot of people, nah, come on, man, just one. No, I gotta finish this, man. If I don't do this tonight, it's not gonna happen. It's not gonna ever get done. So, yeah, that's what it takes.
Okay. Now, let me go here because you just hit something. As far as the personal sacrifice, you know, I can't go to this particular party, or I may not be able to hang with you today. Relationship-wise, because a lot of times we get in relationships and folks who are not in the entertainment industry don't know what this means. You know, they still got grandma's mentality. Oh, you got a little song. Okay, that's cute. That's good. But you still going to come up in here and take this trash out or whatever. My great aunt, God bless her. God help her, honey. She said up there, oh, you're going to be an actor. Oh, that's good. That's good. But I need you to go down here to the county building because they hiring for clerk typist. And you can do, you know, she gave me that. Okay, and did not understand, honey. No, sweetie, no. I can't be in nobody's office sitting up here all day like that, you know. You know. So let me hear that from your perspective. What was it that you were doing prior to getting into, or may still be doing, until that quote unquote big break or that whatever? Because a lot of folks don't understand. Yes, I had to sweep a floor, but in between sweeping this floor, that was to give me the money to get to the studio, you know,
to pay
for this, you know, or that paid for these particular vocal lessons, or that paid for this dance course because I got to learn how to stretch so that I could get the dance performance together. You know, what were some of the things that you were doing prior to, you know, going into the studio?
It's like to make money, a bee is chasing me right now, and I'm terrified of bees. sidebar. to make money, what I did was, you know, I in New York, what kept me going was I sang a wedding dance, and a lot of us do it. A lot of us have done it in the past. Jennifer Hudson, to name one person I know, definitely, you know, she's a wedding singer, and that's what I did to pay my bills. And then other things that I have to do throughout my day, it's all about balance, you know, it's all about balance, because I know it can't be all about, okay, I have studio, you know, because you still have a life and you still have to, you know, make time for certain other things. So it's definitely something you literally have to sit down and map out, you know, like, okay, cool. You know, it's a scheduling kind of thing, you know, where this day I got to, you know, focus on this, that. But the things that are not important and the things that are just, okay, like, say, for instance, a party, you know, I can do without a party, you know. So it's basically, you know, prioritizing, you know. That's what I like to do, prioritize and what's more important, you know, what's going to go towards my career, what's running right now and get it out the way. So that's a major part of how I, you know, schedule my day.
Mm-hmm. All right. Yeah. Well, here, let me do this. Let me take a little break. And when I come back from this break, I want you to go here. Think about this particular question. Of all of the elements that are out here, okay, in dealing with this business, and I love asking this question, being the man that you are on the road and carrying on, what keeps you from falling into the traps of sex, drugs, and rock and roll that the music industry has? Because, you know, when I lost Michael, you know, drug addiction, overdose, and carrying on, you know, at somebody else's hands. We done lost Whitney, you know, at her own hands and carrying on, getting caught up. All these, you know, this beautiful, beautiful voice, and it's gone. You know, Vesta Williams talks about, you know, how she got caught up before she passed. So, you know, that whole thing, you know, we hear about the bad boys. We hear about this, the whole tearing up the damn. I work for a hotel. So, you know, folks come up in here tearing up fucking hotel suites and carrying on because you feel you can.
Oh, man.
And I'm hotel security. So on top of that, right, so I'm the fucker that got to put these bitches out and carrying on. They done came up in here and done tore up everything, you know, and shit. And you sitting up here looking like you for real? For real. You know what I'm saying? And you had to do this. Why? Just because you feel you can. You know, so, talk about how do you not succumb to it? Because the temptation to do it is so strong because that's all that this business is. So folks want to believe. So think on that. We're going to play a commercial. Okay. I'm going to take a little commercial break, and when we come back, we're going to get into that because I need to hear this. Yeah, I need to hear this from you. We'll be right back. Ladies and gentlemen, we are talking with Shaliek, baby. We'll be right back in just a few moments.
Trade Day Management and Publicity Firm, an Atlanta-based PR production and management consultancy firm specializing in aggressive publicity and exposure campaigns, artist development, leveraging mutually beneficial relationships, and brokering deal with integrity. At Trade Day Management, enjoy a touch of Southern hospitality with a universal appeal. For all of your public relations and entertainment management needs, contact Travion Davenport at 678-523-3088. That's 678-523-3088. Or email at tradeaypr@gmail.com. That's tradeay, TREADAYPR at gmail.com. Trade Day Management and Publicity Firm. The Big Brothers Network. Yeah, men of color, men of size. The Big Brothers Network was created to celebrate the larger man of color and those who admire him. We intend to promote a positive self-image within our community and the mainstream population. Our goal is to embrace our differences, to inspire self-love, and increase camaraderie through positive brotherly interactions. We intend to accomplish these goals through the BBN magazine, local and national events, and networking forums. For more information or to catch the latest copy of the BBN magazine, please go to www.bigbrothersnetwork.com. That's www.bigbrothersnetwork.com. The Big Brothers Network, men of color, men of size. PharosTreasureBox.com, a quality online Detroit mobile business. Custom, affordable, high-quality, handcrafted art, jewelry, gifts, and accents for you, your event, home, office, or business. Contact Peter Jackson, Artistic Director, at 248-688-5178. 248-688-5178. PharosTreasureBox.com, embracing a fusion of cultures and making art beautifully affordable.
About your smile, I haven't seen you in a while. I really, really miss you now, girl. I can't deny. But when I reminisce, it cuts me like a knife. I guess I need you kind of bad. Really, really want you back, girl. I think you're right. They say a man shouldn't cry, should hold his feelings deep inside, but that's eating me alive. I'm putting down my pride. Can we go back? Let's go way back. Can we go back to how we used to do? Just me and you. Can we go back? Let's go way back. Can we go back to when our love was good? Yeah. I'm Cause you used to be my baby. They say a feelings deep inside, but that's eating me alive. I'm putting down my pride.
Can we go back? Yes, we can, honey. We are back. If you're just joining us, my darlings, honey, we are sitting here talking with the incomparable. This is Shaliek, and that was his song, honey, Can We Go Back? This is one of my favorites right here. I'm like, honey, when I heard it, I said, oh, shit. That's brown liquor music right there, honey. You know. Oh, have mercy. Yeah, I love that. So, yes. You know, it got that. See, I'm one who breaks down music. See, I'm old school like that. I'm 43. And so when I look at this, you know, I'm one who read the liner notes and find out who played the bass song, you know, the bass on this, and find out who the bitches are in the background screaming and carrying on. Okay, who is that alto note? Okay, it's one of these girls right here. You know, because, you know, with all of those components, it helped to, you know, to make the song fuller. Or, like my diva, honey, Miss Stephanie Mills, who would, you know, a lot of times do her own background and how she harmonizes with herself and then layer it and this, that, and that. I'm like, okay, Miss Stephanie, you did that. Okay, Sarah Pitt, to give me this full choir sound and all of that. So, see, I'm like that. And with this particular song, honey, it got that little swing, just enough of a swing to be like, okay, if I want to sit down and slow groove with somebody with it, I can. Or if I just want to sit down and cruise, because when I first heard it, I said, child, this is flip down, drop top, you know, sunglasses, you know, down the coast somewhere. You know, and if you by yourself, honey, done had a breakup or whatever, honey, you get your tears rolling down your face and shit, you know, just enough so that it don't blur your vision, so you don't crash yourself or whatever. But just enough so you can get into it and release whatever this is. I love that song for that. Okay.
Thank you, man. Wow. That's amazing. Thank you, man. Thank you. That's really what, you know, we artists, we just, you know, It's amazing when someone can feel the record and it's an experience in it, you know, and that's what I want this album to do to you know, to the world. That's what I aspire, man, to let, you know, to see happen.
Mm-hmm. All right. Now let's go into this question I posed to you before the break, and that is, how do you keep yourself from succumbing to the ills, the woes, you know, the troubles of what everybody believes this business is, the sex, drugs, rock and roll, the out of controlness, the rambunctiousness? How do you keep yourself grounded?
Wow. You know, I can really get into this question because I did have a taste of it, you know, a taste of depending on a drug, you know, when I lost my record deal with Universal Records. So I can totally understand. And if I kept feeling that need of depending on it, it could have led to something else. So, but when I lost my deal at Universal, I got hooked on weed. I started smoking marijuana a lot.
mm-hmm. because it was my coke. Like, I coke, you know, that was the way for me to coke with it. Like, okay, when I smoked, it made me feel like I can just, like, everything was cool. Like, oh, I'm all right. Like, I'm good right here, you know, because I was really depressed.
Right.
I was really depressed when I lost my record deal. So it made me feel comfortable. Like, you know, I can just, I just felt great. And,
okay.
And so the more, you know, the more and more, you know, I started smoking, the lazier I got. And
say
I was like, man, I'm getting lazy as hell. Like, I'm not doing anymore. I'm just chilling. Like, you know, I'm not trying to even be an artist anymore. And I kind of hit a brick wall with it. I'm like, I can't keep going down this path. And I woke up and I smelled the coffee and I'm like, I got to get up and I got to do something else. And that's when I started songwriting. So songwriting became my marijuana, you know. That was I was coping with the fact that I wasn't an artist anymore. And I just said, let me songwrite. And so I said, I felt better and I was accomplishing something. So I felt more myself. And then back to being an artist, you know, I look back at that. I'm like, I don't want to go back to that same place. So for me now, I know that it's either two reasons for me to want to get hooked on a drug. It's either I need something to calm my anxiety, or I need something to give me wings, like to feel like I can conquer the world. So I pray, you know what I'm saying? I pray, please, Lord, the blood of Jesus all over me, you know what I'm saying? I get a natural high when I hit the stage. So I don't need the drug for that. I don't need the drug to give me wings because something happens when I touch the stage. I don't know what it is, but it turns on. And
no,
I
it's called
anything,
spirit, baby.
I don't need anything to give me high. Yeah, it's a spirit that takes over. And I said, God, if you give me the strength to do this artist thing again and give me the tools I need, just, you know what I'm saying, I'm gonna do this fully and completely. And he gave me that's my drug. I don't know what he's giving me, but when I hit the stage, something happens. And it feels like I'm high, but it's just not. It's the spirit. It's the love. It's the music. Like, when I hear that band start, something happens. Like, I get high. You know, and then to calm me down, because, you know, we as artists, we go through so much, and we have to go through so many different places, do so many different interviews. You got to perform here. You got to be a certain way. So you get anxious, you know, anxiety. And a lot of people do drugs to calm them from that anxiety because it's so much. You're being pulled so many different places. So many people want an autograph. They want a picture. You're a human being, so that type of thing, that's not, a human is not naturally supposed to go through that stuff.
Right.
So what I do is I meditate. I sit down in one place and I calm myself. And when I come from that place, I promise you, my whole day I'm at ease. I'm smooth. I'm not too anxious, because had I been anxious, had I not taken that 15, 20, 30 minutes for myself, I would have still been at that on 10. And when you're on 10 all day, your body is, but you can't, if something happens, you know, your body is not supposed to do that. So
exactly.
That's my drug. Meditation and God are my two drugs.
Okay. Now, see, you hit something. Because I said you hit something because a lot of people don't understand that particular part. When you up there and you hit your zone, on that stage, God, there is nothing else like it.
Yeah.
There's nothing else like it. Okay?
Yeah.
And I always attribute that to spirit because, see, when you're in that space, that there becomes your communication to God and to spirit, and then it becomes a blessing because this is what your gifts are to give to the world, to everybody who's there. You know, and when they're there, and then they start to give you that love back. See, that's the other part of that. So you know what you're doing, but then that audience start to respond, and they start to mirror what you're giving, and they end up giving it back, which ends up taking you higher, and then they go.
That exchange of spirit is amazing,
baby.
Yeah, incredible.
It sends me, and I know for me, as an entertainer, I like to get to the point to where I have just worn myself out, and then on top of it, I'm asthmatic. So, you know, I have to have folks, you know, keep water on the stage or whatever somewhere, because I know I'm going to get dry. I'm going to need something, and have my inhaler, my asthma pump right there. Okay, bitch, y'all know me. Okay. Have my pump right there, because when I take flight, yeah, you know when I'm going to do it. Now, because I get to, there's this certain little bounce I get. I'm like, okay, here we go.
Yeah. You know who I love? You know who I love? Fantasia. I get the same feeling when I see her perform. Like, I feel like I can feel her when she performs because I feel like I can relate to her. Like, I feel the same way when you know, when I'm looking at her, I'm like, I feel the same way when I'm on stage. And I can just relate to her so much. Like, we communicate, you know, telepathically.
Exactly.
But, yeah, she's another person that she does that for me now. Like, a lot of singers and artists today, they don't do that for me.
Right. Well, you know, it again, understanding and not having or feeling the passion in the song, or at least not wanting to tell the story of the song. See, that's what I want to get with you next as far as being the songwriter. Because as the performer, you know how to deliver the song to tell the story. But as the writer, you're the one writing the story. So now, take us on that journey of a songwriter. What is your muse? And I said we were going to get into your personal. So how much of your personal life reflects into your songwriting? And then how much of that reflects into your performance?
Good question. 100% of my personal life, I have to admit, don't go into my music, my songs. But a lot of it does. A lot of it does. I'm a listener by nature. Like, I love to hear. People always come to me with their, you know, because they say I give okay advice. Or sometimes people just want to vent, you know. And I just sit there and I listen. And I'm contently listening, you know what I'm saying? Sometimes people just want to, you know, you hear them. And I say too much. Just vent. And then it's just, I've always been that way. And I think that's, you know, me being a songwriter, it's great that I'm that way because I get all of these different stories and different, you know, scenarios and every conversation to me is a song. It's like, that's what's in my mind. I'm listening, and I'm like, wow, and I'm really listening to this, you know, to whatever the person's venting about, whether it be, you know, a cousin, my own girl, I have a twin sister, you know, whether it be my mother, whether it be my father, whether it be, you know, my uncle, whoever. And I'm in the back of my mind, I'm like, that's a song, you know, but I don't do anything right then and there. But when I hear a track, all of these, you know, these concepts just come to mind based on what I heard maybe a week before, the day before, earlier in that day. So I'm just a sponge to just, you know, just conversations. And it translates to my music.
Oh, okay, cool beans. Yeah. Now, going into that, you know, how difficult is it to take a song and then to write for someone else? Because I see you was a part of the writing team with Cream and Carrying On. And how difficult is that when you got your baby or have a collaboration of your baby? And then, you know, you need to...
What is that?
Ooh, because see, I've written a few songs back when I lived in New York back in 95. I've not done anything with them. They're only lyrics because I only write lyrics. I don't know how to write music or anything. But I know when I wrote them, I had certain people in mind. Now, I know the first thing was to say, I wrote this for you and they don't like it. Okay, just destroy my dream, girl. Okay. Okay. Just crush the fuck out of me. Okay, stomp me like I'm a roach. Why don't you? I'm willing. But then, then you have the flip side of that to where, you know, they may like it, but then the label don't want it. You know, I heard Selena Johnson said that she wrote something for Jennifer Hudson before she became Jen, you know, and it was supposed to win on the album, but then the label didn't like it, so then that got scrapped. I'm like, okay, but what did you do with the song? You know, that was a hot song. Yeah. They didn't want it? What?
Yeah.
You know, so what is that like as a songwriter? Or here we go, they want to give it to somebody who ain't got the chops to do it, and then they finna fuck it up
auto-tuning
and all this old craziness.
As it not being accepted. Me.
Oh, I dig that. Okay. Wow.
If you give it to the wrong person, it's like, you know, it's not what you intended it to be. And that happened a few times with me. You know, it's like I wrote a song intended for someone else, and the other person got it, and it doesn't feel the same. It's only when people hear it, it's not conveyed properly, and it's like it doesn't come across.
because delivery is very important, and vocal delivery is very important with the song.
Exactly.
You can give a song to one person and give it to another person, and the delivery just brings that whole song to life.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so it's incredible. And to answer your question, it's, when I go into a song to studio to write a song, I try to, you know, for someone else, I just back myself out of the situation. I pretend like I'm not even here. You know, it's really hard. In the beginning, when I was writing for other people, it was hard because I didn't have that concept in mind, and I was just going, and I'd be like, I'd be writing it, and when it's finished, I'd be like, man, this would be dope for me. And I'm like, I'm like, I have a writing partner, because he'll be like, give me that song, man. It's not yours. You know what I'm saying? So it kind of helped me, because if it was just me writing, it was like, nah, this is mine. I'm keeping it for myself, you know.
Right.
It's a job you do. You know, you got to go in, and you have to just take yourself out of the situation, and you know, okay, this is, you know, I came here to write for this person, so this is what I'm going to do. So, you know.
Is that always blind, or do you go in knowing sometimes who you're going to write for? Because I've heard it both on both sides, you know, blindly going in, okay, we wrote a song, and then they give it to somebody. Or, you know, they knew that they were writing for this person, then you got to learn this person, you know, find out their quirks and this, that, and the other, and then make sure that this is material that they're going to sing. You know, I heard Patti LaBelle say that, you know, that she heard this song, I heard it, but it really wasn't a Patti song, you know.
Yeah.
Or, what was it, Right Kind of Lover, when she did Right Kind of Lover.
Wow.
And when she did it, it was a lyric in there that she had them change because it was a very sexual, you know, it was very suggestive, too suggestive for her, you know. And she was like, honey, no, we can't say that, okay, in the song. And they wanted to challenge her.
That's catty for sure.
You know. They wanted to challenge her.
Right,
I was like, well, girl, you sitting up there singing about hookers and stuff with Lady Marmalade. You can't sing this? You sit up there talking about voulez-vous. And she say, honey, wait a minute, baby. No, we not going to sit up here and do this because that song was strictly about a hooker. This song ain't about no hooker. It ain't about nothing. It ain't got nothing to do with this line right here. You know?
Yeah.
And when she said that, I screamed. You know? And so they came up with a compromise, and then we have the song, which did wonderful for her, you know.
Right, yeah.
So, you know, in that, so I heard
want.
That
you
on
know,
both
great
sides
artists,
of that.
They know what they want, you know, and it's no disrespect to anyone else, you know. But as an artist, this is your art. This is something that you have to stand behind all of your life, your whole life, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So you have to respect that, you know, in artists. And I'm the same way, you know. Certain things I won't sing. It's certain things I won't say.
Mm-hmm.
It's mine. This is my stuff right here. It's not
right.
Yours. You don't have to sing this song. You don't have to perform this, you know, in front of whoever, you know, for how many years and years and years, how many tours. I have to deliver this message on stage. You know, it has to be believable, you know what I'm saying? Because if it's not, if it's false, or if it's fake, or if it's not true or you know, then you'll never get the message out the way it's
exactly.
supposed to be, you know?
Exactly. And then, too, I'm looking at music and stuff today because, you know, we always say, okay, oldies but goodies and carrying on. And I always say, child, this music nowadays, when my nieces and nephews go back talking about some old school and you go back to Lil' Kim, you know, and I'm like, child, the music is not going to be, you know, a lot of the stuff that they have out now is just it's quick. You know, it's a hit now. You know, I won't even call them one-hit wonders because even the one-hit wonder, you know, it's timeless. You know, even the novelty songs, I mean, hell, you look marvelous from Billy Crystal. It's still, if I were to play that now, for those of us who still remember that song, you know, it would still get a party going. You know what I'm saying? It would still have something in that. But like, oh, my God, I ain't heard this in years. You know,
that kind of
feel. Versus saying, child,
one hit wonder. That word hit is the big word.
Exactly. A hit.
Even though it's only one of them, it's a hit.
Okay, right. You know, so yeah. Oh, goodness. Okay. Then that's interesting because, I've always wanted to hear that from the songwriting end of that, you know, being that you hear.
I'm sorry, Coach. I'm rather going to a session with no one in mind. I'd rather go because it puts you in this box, you know, of, okay, I have to do it this way. And then there's expectations there, because if they don't like it, like, damn, I voted right for you. I thought it was perfect. You know, I listened to it. So it's kind of like it's a letdown. So I'd rather go in and just write a song with no inhibitions. Just go in and just
dig that.
Just let the tracks just take me where it needs to take me. I don't want to know about who I'm writing it for or anything. Just write a beautiful record, and whoever likes it, go ahead and take it.
Okay, dig that. Well, here, let me go here, because before I start to bombard you with everything else, I want the folks to come on in, because we want to talk about the past. The first single that is coming from Blood, Sweat, and Tears. It takes blood, sweat, and tears to relinquish the past. Okay. So now let's go into this. No. Don't go into it yet. Let me play it first, and then let the folks get the feel for it, and then we'll get the behind-the-scenes story. How about that? This is the past, everybody.
This is love and war, and all is fair. But to bring that up, to bring it here. And I used to think you wouldn't dare. But I never thought you wouldn't care. You refuse to let it go, then you refuse to let it grow. Girl, it's either now or then. When you choose, let me know, 'cause I don't really want to dwell. You say you forgive me, but every chance you get, you make me feel guilty. You know I hate it when you bring up the pain. For you, don't leave it there. I got a present for you. I call it the moment. Let's live in it. For things we gotta get over, let's build a bridge in it. If you refuse to let it go, then you refuse to let it grow. Girl, it's either now or then. When you do, let me know. 'Cause I don't really wanna dwell. Thank you. Forgive me, but every chance you get, you make me feel guilty. You know I hate it when you bring up the past.
right now. Okay, the tea room was blowing up, child. Mustang Sally said, you know, I hate it when you bring up the past. I am loving this song, honey.
Thank you,
all right. Pharaoh's Box said, I love this song. That's the truth all the way around, baby.
Yeah.
Love it.
It's on iTunes if you want to hear it again.
Okay, right. Oh, we'll get put it out there. It's on iTunes.
It's on iTunes right now. So iTunes is on Amazon too for like the Androids. Because if you don't have an iPhone, you gotta go to Amazon, and it's there. It's available on Amazon as well.
Okay. So now let's get into the science of this song, honey. Because when I heard this, I said, "Oh, okay." See, that sounds like a real conversation because, you know, when I first heard this, I saw myself, and I know, and everybody who knows me know, I could get pissed kind of easily because I'm allergic to stupid shit. I can't stand nothing stupid. Okay? Okay.
It was funny when you said, I'm sorry to cut you off.
No, that's all right. Go ahead. Go for it. It's your show.
Smartphone. And you called it a stupid-ass phone. I was cracking up when I heard that. That's sort of hilarious. But, yeah, go ahead.
Okay. But when I heard the song, the way how that line hits me, it was one of them, I'm walking away from you, and then somebody says something, and you turn around, and you just say, you know, I hate when you bring up, you know, when you grit in your teeth. And that's how that hit me when I first heard it. I was like, ooh, damn it. Okay, because it became real for me at that moment. You know what I mean? And it's like, ooh, okay. And then I started to get my bounce because I'm like, okay, see, he's finna say something. Say it, you know? And and that's where that song takes me, you know? And it's like, wow, okay. We supposed to have been over this and this, that, and the other. You still bringing up old shit. You know, it's like being at the family reunion and shit done happened 25 years ago. You still talking about, I owe you $5 from when you helped me get some gas in that 1925. I'm like, you, what? John, if you don't, okay. Got this little deuce and a quarter. You said, child, we up in here. I'm in the escalator. You talk about $5 for when I was in the deuce and a quarter. Yeah. Okay. So what was it when you put that together? You know, what is the message? Because with this being the lead song, and here it is, because I've always thought that, you know, especially with record labels and stuff, the lead song, I've always thought that they set the tone for the album, but that's not necessarily true, and I had to learn that the hard way because I'm a B-side girl. I love, you know, the song that should have been played that's on the album, I'm the B-side child. That should have been the hit right there. So what is the message of this particular song? Why was it chosen to be the first single? And then let's go through Blood, Sweat, and Tears, the entire project, and its message.
Absolutely. Well, the past was just that record that when everyone heard it across the board, it was just that undeniable, just, okay, we need for people to know exactly who you are in your first single, you know, just who you are as an artist, you know, the fact that you're a soul singer, the fact that you can really sing, not to my own horn, but you can really sing, and you have conviction in your delivery. You need that to come across in your first single because, you know, these days you only get one chance at being, at really something really sticking because if people don't, you know, it's like you only have a chance, one chance. That's how I was taught. And so what's going to be your best representation of you? And across the board, you know, I agreed initially. Like, I was like, this is one of my favorite songs, period. You know, we have other, as I'm recording the album, you know, the bar has been set so high that now I have to keep going there. And Pendulum Records, Ruben Rodriguez, who's the CEO and co-founder, he's like, you're not giving me anything less than this. You know, this is a bar. You know, so it's giving me a way, a chance to really be creative and really put my all into my project because the bar is so high with this record. And I just feel like the world can relate to it, whatever situation you're in, you know. And my reason for singing this record, because I didn't write it, I wrote the bridge too. But when I heard it, I immediately connected to it, because what it means for me, what it means for me is my career, because I had let everything go. I really didn't want to be an artist anymore. I was upset with a lot of people who I thought did me wrong, and that just wasn't behind me. And I was holding on to this grudge and this anger. And as soon as I let that go, things started moving, you know? And I never looked back. I never looked back. And I said, I'm going to leave the past in the past, and I'm going to just keep going. And for me, that's why the song is so, it means so much to me, because that's what it means, you know? It's not about a girl for me. It can be about a girl for somebody else, but it's about my career.
Dig it. Listen, when you were saying it, I was just about to say, was this a message to yourself? Ooh, that's hot. You know,
and that's why it was powerful for me, because it wasn't obvious. You know what I'm saying?
Get out of here. I'm going to hit you with a wet noodle now. I love it.
It's true. You know, so when I heard the record, I said, wow. Like, you saying exactly what I wanted to say. And I would have never said those words. I would have probably just wrote it, you know, just about a girl or a situation I was in. But when I heard it, like outside of me writing it, you know, when I heard it, when I was actually step out of the box and hear it, that's how it hit me. You know what I'm saying? So I said, I have to sing this, because it's everything I want to say.
All right. Now, what is Shaliek's message in his music? You know, as you look at your body of work, as you look at you pouring your heart and soul into this, and as a soul singer, what is your soul trying to say to the people? What is your soul saying?
To be encouraged. I want for, like, with Sam Cooke and Donnie Hathaway did for me, I want someone to say do for other young singers, you know, whether it be male or female, you know what I'm saying, little boy or little girl. Just to watch me at an award show or do a performance or interview and just say, I want to be like him, and just continue this wave of just good, timeless, great music. Because I feel like they saved my life, you know, Donny Hathaway and Stevie and Sam, those are my heroes. Mm. And they gave me, they gave me just, you know, something to not to live for, because I would have been doing something else, but they kept me in that positive light. I'm from the hood. I'm from the Bronx, New York. I couldn't be doing anything out here in the streets, but I wanted to be a singer. I wanted to be like them. So they kept me focused on, you know, something positive. So that's my message, you know?
Dig that. All right, now let me go right there with that hood piece right there, that hood piece. Because here's where it is. Because for so long, we have this era where everybody wants to be, you know, they got to rep the hood. You know, a lot of the hip-hop R&B now is always supposed to be repping the hood. Ghetto done became fabulous, you know, and this, that, and the other. So what is it about you that says, you know, I'm from the hood, but the message is not hood message. This is about taking yourself and being better than the hood. You know, so what is that for you? And does that become a problem with you and other artists? Because you know how we had that rival back in the day, and how everybody was up in everybody's faces, or you ain't real, you fake, you phony, all that. How's that playing with you?
I don't, and it's not something that, it's probably like the first or the second time I ever really said I'm from the hood, you know, because I don't just, you know, I feel like we're from where we're from, you know, whether it be, whether it be from, you know, a middle-class neighborhood, whether it be, you know, low-class, whether it be, I feel like, you know, you shouldn't feel like you have to be a product of where you're from in your environment. And that's why it's important to create music or be, you know, as responsible adults, you know, just encourage the youth so that way they don't feel like all they have is where they're from. You know what I'm saying? So I never really,
that.
I mean, that's my responsibility, I feel like, as an artist. You know what I'm saying? So I'm never afraid to say where I'm from, but I don't throw it out there and posted out there either, you know. And there's never been any beef or anything, any other artists and stuff like that, thank God, in that area, you know what I'm saying? So it's always, you know, it's just about the music for me, and it's about just creating the best music I can and just go out there and have fun and just, you know, make money and take care of my mother and, you know, those things. Yeah.
Okay.
I'm taking my mom. My mom's like, did you make it yet? Where's the money? Where's the money coming out?
Okay, man, see, she's been listening to Steve Harvey's sister and carrying on. That's what that is. You know, because nephew Tommy had his shit every time he turned around.
She moved us, you know, from New York to, you know, to Charleston, to down south, where she felt it was better to raise us, and she did so much on us, so. I just want to, you know, be able to pay her and just take care of her. You know?
No, well, you know what? And it's not so much as repay her. What it is just be the blessing that she raised you to be. See, were the blessing to her.
That's
you know what I'm saying?
Like, no,
and now she gave you the tools.
That's how you
repay
her.
Yeah. Yeah, and that's all. That's all because see, that's the continuous circle. One of the things about life is that we're always supposed to be better than the parents. You know that's how it's designed. The parents are set the bar, and now it is up to you to be better than, because you're taking it and moving forward. And see, as you move forward, of course they're coming along because they're right there. The parents, good parents, that is, and I'm not talking about the ones who
done. I did that. You know, that's me. That's my.
You know, and this, that, and the other. You know, that comes through because they coming along because they always got your back. You know, while you moving up, they're the ones pushing you. So as you taking that step, they right there pushing you to make sure that you go, because they've gone where they could take it. So now they pushing you, go on, baby, do it. Go on, baby, do it. Go on, baby, do it.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
mm-hmm.
and that kind of thing. So, hell, they going to be right there. So it's not about repaying them. No, child, shit, hell. You know.
Yep.
That's what it is.
Right.
I got to build this estate. I got to get, my mama wants the East Wing. Okay? She was saying that since I was 12 years old. She wants the house and she wants the East Wing of the house. Okay? Which means I've got to have this bitch built from the ground up so she can have her entire East Wing with her own kitchen and carrying on so she can do what she wants to do.
That's mama's side right there. That's mama's side.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I am obsessed with that. And I've got to do this, you know, because I need her to be in it to enjoy it and carrying on and all of that. I've got to do, God help me, because I've got to do this. And that's where it is. You know, that's part of my driving force, because mama getting his house, damn it. You know? So, yeah, that's what that is. So, now let's go here, because, of course, being in this industry, you know, there are a lot of folks would see you as having a certain expectation, a certain, being in a certain demographic, you know, wanting to throw themselves at you because of you being able to sing and carry on. You know, that whole Eddie Kang thing, honey, and all of the greats, you know, they're throwing the panties up there, they're throwing the this. How are you able to maintain yourself? You know, being the man that you are and understanding that you're a man, okay?
Yeah.
And all of that. And I'm being very decent here because everybody know I got a potty mouth and I could really get gutter with that. But I'm being cute, okay? So, you know, how are you maintaining your personal self? You know, that's a secondary question, without getting caught up and what we know the business to be. Daddy Kane just sat up there on his what was that, the Unsung or whatever, talking about how he woke up with four different girls in the bed. Four girls in the bed. These bitches crazy. Because, okay, you just doing it because he got money. You know, girl, you better move. Okay, so how do you maintain that and then keep your dignity and your integrity, you know, to yourself? You know, and that's not to say you ain't done nothing, because we all got a little dirt. We all got our dirt.
Yeah.
You know, however, you know,
I mean,
but how do you
know,
how do you do
that? As a young man, you know, I like to have fun. I like to do my, you know, I got my dirt, you know. But I've always been, I don't know, my mama raised me right. Like, she just, I don't know. I've always been a gentleman. Like, even with hanging out with the fellas and, you know, of course, yeah, we hollering at girls and it's like, whatever, whatever. You know, we do our thing. But I never took it too far. I've never been the type of person to disrespect women and you know, that type of thing. That's just not who I am as a person. And I've never been ashamed of that. Like, I never felt like I had to do anything like that to fit in. You know, that's my personality, and I'm strong with it. And this is who I am. If you don't like it, then, you know, we ain't got to chill. We ain't got to hang out. You can joke on me or whatever. You can whatever. We laugh, whatever. But if it's an issue, then we're good. I've always been like that in my personality. I'm set my own ways. And my mother told me to just be a leader, you know what I'm saying? And so, yeah, I mean, I might meet an attractive female or a woman or whatever. And, I talk to her, and it's just never like that crazy where I'm with 5 and 6 different women at the same time and playing all of them. Like, that's not who I am.
Mm-hmm.
You know? And so, but, you know, I have fun. You know, we have parties and, you know, when I'm not working, and we, you know, we do our thing. It's all about it being young and grown up, and, you know, I'm not married. I'm single, so. Hey,
yo,
here we go.
Yeah. All right. Now, what is it that tickles your fancy for those who are, because I have to ask this for the, okay, wait a minute, let me say this before you answer that. Listen, Sugars, now I'm getting a little bit into his business. I'm going to let him answer this however he answers this. When he answers this, do not bug the fuck up out of me about anything else. You understand? Because whatever answer he gives is the answer we're going to take. You understand? So, listen carefully. So, when y'all come to one of his concerts again, no, you come correctly. You understand? All right. Now, go on and answer your question.
You said, what tickles my fancy?
Yeah. What is it that tickles your fancy? When you see a young woman or whatever, what gets your eye? What is it that you look for as a single man, you know, at least right now? Because, you know, until you find the one that's going to take your name and you're going to put a ring on it or whatever, what tickles your fancy?
It's different things about certain women, but the things that stand out for me in a woman is I love her. I love lips. I'm a lip guy. I like a woman with nice lips. Okay, and beside the lips, I go down, scroll down. I'll stop there right quick and I look. Okay, cool, go down. The legs.
Mm.
I like legs. I like nice legs. Yeah. And with heels on.
Ah, you got a shoe fetish. Okay. Bitches, listen. He like heels, girl.
Long legs with heels, yeah.
Now listen, let me tell y'all this.
That
tickles
my fancy.
Let me tell you this, sisters. Please listen to me very carefully, because I'm so sick of y'all looking like damn drag queens. It's ridiculous. I'm sick of it. If you go wear some heels, honey, make sure you got them. The Come Fuck Me pumps, honey, are cute. But if you can't walk in them damn things and you look like you stomping roaches, they too high. Take them down a notch. Don't wear the 8 inches. Wear the 5.
That's all a part of the package when you got your sexy looking heels on and your legs looking nice and it's nice and, you know, oiled up and it looks soft, and then you looking crazy when you walk. It's like you mess up the whole picture for me. It's like you got this sexy walk with it. It completes it. You know,
exactly.
You know what I'm saying? But
that's
when you're walking
part
crazy,
of
it's
it.
Like you defeat the purpose. You defeat the purpose, ladies. You know what I'm saying? So, like,
would
no,
you
I have to
say that
walk.
Again.
That's a big equation, you know. Walk sexy, walk confident in your heels, and you know, and look like you know how to walk in them.
If you feel as though if you're looking like you stepping on roaches, honey, that's because the heel is too damn high. Now y'all talking to a drag queen, honey. I'm telling you, the heel is too high. That's what that means.
Take it down a couple inches, ladies. Take it down a couple inches. And
all
you
need,
what?
You ain't. Go ahead.
When it's so, because I'm not, I'm a average height guy. I'm probably a little less than average. I mean, height guy. You know what I'm saying? So when you put on them 1,000-inch heels, you tower over me, and that's not sexy neither. And I like long legs. You know what I'm saying? So it's like, if it don't have to be so high, you got to do it so high. You know, cut it down a couple of inches.
And as long as you're walking nice, you know what I'm saying? Nice walk is always good.
That's the whole thing. If y'all pay attention, honey, with Beyonce doing all that cutesy-cutesy walking and carrying them, when she popping, she ain't in them damn 8-inch pumps, honey. She's in 4s. You better clock it, okay? Get it, okay?
Y'all better listen to him. You know what he's talking about.
Listen, because that upsets me. I'm so tired of it. I am so sick of that. I tell you, I work in a hotel. So every time I see these girls, they come out, they're getting ready to go to the club, they sit up there, you got the dress on that you know. I get so tired of y'all yanking that damn dress. You know damn well it's going to rise. And every 2 seconds, every step you take, you pulling it down. You pulling it down. Oh. So you're doing all that, and then you got these shoes that's too damn high, and you look like at any given moment you finna trip over your own feet because you half walking. And then before you get to the car, you know, took the shoes off, talking about, ooh, my feet hurt. Girl, stop. Okay. That's my soapbox. I didn't mean to do that right now. But I'm trying to sit up there. Sisters, I'm trying to get y'all to listen to the man now. He tell you what he like. He said he's single. So when y'all come to the concerts and hear him singing, carrying on, you come correct, okay?
Yeah.
And please act like you know what you damn doing. He say now, y'all heard what he said, and I said I'm going to let him have his answer, and that's that. Don't y'all come bother me. Don't bother me. Don't bother me. Okay?
Yeah. And when the lips are nice and, you know, not too shiny, but, you know, a little bit shiny with whatever y'all put on it, the gloss or whatever, you know, yeah.
Lip gloss, honey. You want your lips to be accentuated. You're not drawing on lips. If you don't have full lips, the lip gloss is not supposed to make you look like Duckula. Okay? Okay? Now, I'm just saying. Wait a minute. Let me. You know what? That goes into this song. Y'all catch this. Catch this track, y'all.
Everything ain't what it seem. I was blinded by that bubble in them jeans. You and your girl, back to back. Legs bubble in the beam. Looking like something out of dreams. Shit, knowing me, Fred Krueger. No, I can't lose her. Hotel room playing Shaliek in a Uber. No elevator, so I stepped to her. Open, ooh, cause I spoke too soon.
I was taken by those pretty eyes. You're running all through my mind. It's something like a butterfly. Cause baby, you're just that fly. I try, but I just can't keep my cool. Baby, I can't deny I'm falling deeper for you. Same game, same shit. Me and
my dog was messing with the same pitch.
Hey, okay, we are back. Did I just lose him? Oh, I hope I didn't. It looks like I have. Oh, you have got to be kidding me. Oh, my goodness. Okay, wait a minute. Let me see if we can pull him back up. And, yeah, damn it. That was not supposed to happen. I had a couple more questions, and I wanted him to put his information out there where you can find all of his music. And how you can become a fan of his, honey. Are you enjoying the music so far? Let me find out what's going on. Let me take a quick commercial. Y'all listen to this, and then when I come back, hopefully he'll be back with us. So let me go here right now.
Icha. Vidal. Couture, Icham, Vidal, Couture. Enjoy high fashion with luxurious twist. Step into the future with fresh, innovative couture. Designed by Miss Michi. DeVale, Michi, DeVale. For more information, contact Michi at 313-996-9807. 313-996-9807, or go to Facebook and go to facebook.com/MichiDeVale. That's MichiDeVale. Michi DeVale, Icham, Vidal, Couture.
Yeah.
Get his mic. No. Oh, dang, blast it. It didn't come through. Okay, we're going to try that one more time. But while we're waiting, I just had one more thing that I needed him to do, and I want to make sure you guys get his music. But in the meantime, while we're waiting for that, let me reintroduce you to what's going on starting this weekend and every weekend for the month of May. Honey, we have the Shop Nibble Network Old School Bazaar every weekend, Fridays and Saturdays here. Well, not here, but in the city of Detroit. I'm in Atlanta. But in the city of Detroit, this event is sponsored by Pharaoh's Treasure Box, Five Mo Artists, and Mr. Harvey of African Easy Silk Hair Care Products, hair and skincare products, that is. So, my darlings, I want you to pay attention to that. If you have any questions and need more information about it, please call 248-688-5178. That's Mr. Jackson's number, and you can find out more information. If you are a vendor and want to come on out for a one-time fee of $35, you can set up a table for all 8 days of that weekend. So, again, 248-688-5178 for more information on that if you are in the Detroit and surrounding areas. Okay, we're back. I think I got him. Shaliek?
Oh, we're back.
Yeah, we are back. I'm like, oh, my God,
what happened, man? We was having a good old convo.
I know, and carrying on. And then I just got word, honey, that you know, when you're doing press junkets and carrying on, everybody is everywhere. So let me make this quick because I know you got to get set up for something else. But the major thing that I wanted – that spoke too soon just came right there. That was beautiful. That was a beautiful setup for that song. Okay. And then I just got to playing Reaching. So let everybody know exactly where they can find you, where to go to get your music, to get the first mixtape or whatever, because I bought it for $5. I got it.
So
tell everybody
where
you can get it.
First and foremost, The Past is my single off of Blood, Sweat, Tears. That's on iTunes as well as Amazon. So if you go those two places, you'll definitely see it. Thank you for the support in advance. Also, the video is out, so you can YouTube The Past video, Shaliek. So say The Past, Shaliek. What else? Blood, Sweat, Tears comes out in July, around July. It's the full album. And it was some other things I'm going to do. Oh, my Twitter. It's Official Shaliek. That's S-H-A-L-I-E-K. Then we have a fan page on Facebook, which is Shaliek, S-H-A-L-I-E-K. So go there. We keep everybody updated and things like that.
All right. This is a very interesting name. What is your heritage?
I'm African American.
With Shaliek? Okay. You sure
Muslim,
you ain't got no...
Huh?
Okay.
People think it's Muslim.
I'm thinking Creole or something. But I'm
she just got real creative with it and just said, yeah, it's a name.
Oh, okay.
She wanted something unique,
unique.
My sister's name is Shakia. My name is Shaliek, and we're twins. So she wanted to do the unique thing. So.
Oh, get up out of here. Twins.
Yeah,
Shaliek and Shaliek. Okay. Well, how about that? All right. I'm digging it.
Oh, and I also want to leave a website, too. You can get snippets on pendulumrecords.biz. So P-E-N-D-U-L-U-M records.biz. And there's snippets of some other cuts on the album, Blood, Sweat, Tears.
All righty then.
Yeah.
Well,
yeah.
I think I have set up here... And picked your brain, honey. Enough for right now.
That was a great conversation, man. I had a good time on your show. Definitely, for real.
Well, I thank you for that. So at this particular point, let me just say officially thank you. Let me thank Pendulum Records. Let me thank Double Exposure for introducing you to my consciousness, honey. I'm living for this. I'm completely living for this. And you sound to be a cool little brother now. Go ahead on now. Do your thing. Okay, and with that, when you're ready for the release of the album or whatever, get back with me because we'll bring you on, and honey, we'll have a listening party right here, and we'll do the thing. Do you hear what I'm saying? We'll do it. We'll do it. Okay. So now you get to your other, because I know you got a next appointment to carry on. Y'all keep me posted, and my pleasure, my brother.
All right. Thank you, man. Pleasure was all mine.
All right. Peace. All right, ladies and gentlemen, honey, that was Shaliek, and I'm living for it, honey. I'm the soul singer. Can you stand it? I love it. So, yes, I hope everything that I played today was Shaliek's music, okay? Everything that you've heard musically has been all of his music. And, again, you can go pendulumrecords.biz to hear snippets of the new piece. On Facebook, he's Shaliek. And on Twitter, he's the Official Shaliek. And, yes, that there is lovely. That's S-H-A-L-I-E-K, okay? S-H-A-L-I-E-K. That there is lovely, honey. I hope that you had a wonderful time with all of that. I told you I was introducing the song and presenting to others. So with that, my darlings, I've got to get ready. I hope tonight, honey, you're paying attention. If I'm not a reality show buff. However, this is one that I watch because I know these girls, and that is R&B Divas. It is debuting tonight, season 2, on TV One. So tonight we're doing a viewing party, so I've got to go get beautified and, put my wrinkle cream on and all that kind of jazz. I got to shave. Jesus, I got stubble. Oh, okay. Yeah, so... let me go beautify and carry on. That's going to take a couple of hours. This thing started at 7:30, child. It's already 3. So, yeah, I got to soak it. Yeah. So let me do all that. Finish all of your crumpets, darling, because the tea has been dished, and you've been dishing tea, darlings. Ah, with big meats, honey. I love you. If you love me, tell a friend. If you hate me, tell an enemy. But do know this one way, shape, style, form, or fashion. This thing here we'll move forward. Until next time, honey, join us next week. We'll be talking with Dr. Angelo Reynolds, a psychology professor and public speaker, and we'll be talking with him and understanding how you too could overcome obstacles and to maximize your potential. And we're going to get into all of that with him and talk about this educational piece. So that's going to be next week's show. Join us then. And until then, honey, I will talk with you again. Once again, to my special friend, honey, who has a birthday today, happy birthday, baby. I love you immensely. Okay, ta-ta.
The Starlight Lounge presents An Evening with the Progressive Box.
Oh, what a great audience. Let's dim the lights for this next one. Nope, too much. Ah, there it is. Got to get things just right. Like Progressive's Name Your Price tool. Tell us what you want to pay, and we help you find coverage options that fit your budget. And now, the mood is right. Wait, the lights are back on again. Trudy, can you? And now it's completely dark.
Progressive Casualty Insurance Company and Affiliates. Price and coverage match limited by state law.